And 680's Richard Southern joins us on this very sunny Monday. It's beautiful weather, isn't it, Rich?
Lovely. How was your weekend?
It was very good. It was very busy, but, you know, still Mother's recovering.
Day. You do something nice for your wife on Mother's Day?
I had my wife, my mother-in-law, my own mother, my aunt. It was a wonderful
weekend.
Lots of moms
to take care of.
Lots
That's
of
nice.
Moms, but it was all good.
Very good. I brought my mom out for dinner yesterday. Nice time had by all. So there
oh,
you go.
Very good. Very good. Let's talk about marijuana stocks. They were way up on Bay Street thanks to two big announcements today.
Absolutely. Some big deal making. In fact, Francis, the biggest deal making yet we've seen in Canada's cannabis sector. It's Aurora Cannabis buying rival Medreleaf for $3.2 billion. So two of the biggest Canadian pot producers joining forces here. They'll combine to make a $7 billion company, one capable of producing 50,000 kilograms of pot per year. I'm just off the phone here with Cam Batley, Aurora's chief corporate officer, and he says once marijuana is legal here in Canada later this summer, watch out for big companies from alcohol and tobacco that'll come calling.
I do believe that major players from brewers, distillers, tobacco companies, pharmaceutical companies, and perhaps even consumer products companies are looking very hard at moving into the cannabis sector. And why not? It's not every day that you invent a new global industry. And where are you going to go to find out the leaders? It's got to be Canada, because we're the only ones in the world that have this experience, this quality of production, this scale of production, and the access to capital. So it makes an awful lot of sense. It's entirely rational for these other mature industries to be looking very closely at the cannabis sector.
And the other big news of the day, Francis, was Canopy Growth, another big pot producer planning to list its stock on the New York Stock Exchange. So Canopy shares are up more than 8.5%. And an all-hell Bay Street closed higher for a seventh straight day.
Wow. Well, the U.S. Supreme Court has overturned the national ban on sports betting. Now, that opens the door for individual states to allow sports wagering.
Yeah, and it might prompt some change here in Canada too, Francis. So the Supreme Court overturning this law that bans sports betting outside of Nevada, right? You know, up until now, you could really only do it in Las Vegas. Yet millions of Americans, as do many Canadians, bet on sports illegally using offshore online casinos. So that's going to change in the U.S. It's going to bring it back above board. Some wonder if it will prompt Ottawa to modernize its sports betting laws. The Canadian Gaming Association believes that Canadians wager $10 billion illegally every year on sports, with much of that money flowing offshore. You can use ProLine here in the province of Ontario, but you're restricted to betting on multiple games, not single games. So there's a possibility, Francis, this could change that, and a possibility, too, that it could boost sports ratings and boost the value of those sports teams.
So a Canadian media company is selling its majority stake in Peanuts.
Yeah. This is DHX Media out of Halifax, Francis, and they are selling their majority stake in the Peanuts entertainment business to Sony for $237 million. It's going to help it tackle some debt on the books. DHX Media will retain a 41% interest in Peanuts. Sony now will hold a 39% stake, and the family of Peanuts creator, Charles Schulz, will continue to own a 20% stake. Sony says it wanted in on Peanuts because they believe they can grow it in Asia. Snoopy and other Peanuts characters, they're extremely popular in Japan, Francis. They're featured on everyday goods from t-shirts to chopsticks. So Sony thinks it can grow that brand across Asia.
You know, I was thinking that you were going to say that's a nutty decision. They bought it for peanuts, but nothing.
My pun game is not on today. I apologize. Not very punny today.
Well, it is a mystery that's transfixed the world for more than 4 years. But experts finally say there is consensus now on what actually happened to Malaysia Airlines Flight 370.
Yeah, of course, it went missing with more than 239 people aboard more than 4 years ago, Francis. But yes, these investigators now say they believe that the captain of this plane, Captain Zahari, intentionally flew it into the ocean. They say he flew this airliner along the Malaysia-Thailand border, crossing in and out of each country's airspace to avoid detection. Interesting point, Francis. They say he dipped the wing of the plane to see the island of Penang. That was his hometown, and they believe he wanted to see it one last time. They then speculate he put on an oxygen mask before depressurizing the plane to render the passengers and crew unconscious. The biggest takeaway for this, Francis, is that they believe he intentionally flew this plane into the Indian Ocean some 5 hours later. Pieces of the wing that have washed ashore show evidence that it was configured. The flaps were for landing and show evidence of a controlled water ditching. No comment yet from Malaysia Airlines on this.
So after years of decline, frozen food sales are heating up.
Yeah, they are. Consumers have shied away from that freezer case for quite some time, but that's changing now. Brands like Eggo Waffles and Stouffer's, they say they're selling more of their frozen offerings. Frozen food sales are growing here in 2018 for the first time in 5 years. Even millennials, the younger people who consider themselves foodies, are embracing things like frozen vegetables. Frozen vegetable sales have actually been particularly strong, jumping 4.5% in the last year. It's believed that, you know, it's a convenience thing, pre-chopped. They're considered, you know, a bit healthier and certainly cheaper than eating out. Vegans are also gravitating more towards the freezer aisle, looking for products like meat-free burgers. So there you go, Francis.
Well, saw blades, bacon, rancid cheese. I've never held a page with one of those, but ask a librarian, and they're finding some really strange things between the pages.
Yeah, the people use as bookmarks, but then forget to take them out before they bring the book back to the library. One U.S. librarian complained on Twitter that she's recently seen three cases of cheese being used as a bookmark, and she's begging people to stop. So other librarians checked in with the craziest things they found as bookmarks, Francis. So not only a cheese slice, but a saw blade has been found before in a book. Banana skins, cooked and buttered broccoli used to save a page. Fried chicken leg, Lego, a used condom, as well as money and flowers. The things you find in the library, Francis. I bet you never thought you'd see that.
And if you thought the story was interesting between the pages, oh, no, no. The money. Yes. Now, see, I would take the money. That would be fine.
That's not a problem, I don't think.
That's the only thing on the list. That's
the
acceptable.
Only thing you'd want on there for sure.
Right. And Lego, we've used Lego. However, we remove the Lego before you send it back to the library.
But yeah, your kids are going to have to keep that Lego. Yeah. So you can step on it later, on a later date.
That's right. All right. Thank you, Richard. We'll see you tomorrow.